The mesenchymal cells, they are transformed into what? They are transformed into muscle. A special muscle is formed. This muscle is called ciliary muscle, or it is also called ciliaris. You see, this is that muscle. And along with that, here these mesenchymal cells, they will form special fibers that are originating at one end. They are originating from the ciliary body, and then they are attaching to the lens capsule at its equator, like this. At its equator, they are attaching to the lens capsule. So they are basically anchoring the lens. So you see, lens is not just floating into the 3D space. Actually, there is the formation of these lens fibers which are anchoring it. These are not toothpicks here, although I don't know why they are looking like toothpicks. Actually, these are special fibers called zonular fibers, and they originate from the mesenchyme present in this region. You know, this is full of mesenchyme, and this mesenchyme, it comes here through the choroid fissure that we have already discussed in the previous lecture. And this mesenchyme that came from that choroid fissure, it will also form the vitreous body or vitreous humor, and along with that, it has already formed here the zonular fibers or fibers of Zinn. Fibers of Zinn, let me write it here, fibers of Zinn, which help in anchoring the lens, and they attach the lens to the ciliary body. And of course, along with that, we have the that muscle which is the ciliaris, all the ciliary muscle. And please remember, it's again a ring-like muscle. It's a three-dimensional structure. Don't tell anyone that only this triangular shape is the muscle. This is the cut section of the muscle. Actually, it's a whole ring like this. We have cut it here. So don't get confused. Please remember that unlike the iris, you see, the muscles of iris, they arise from the anterior or pigment epithelium. That is special type of muscle which is called myoepithelium. But this is not myoepithelium. This is the muscle which arises from the mesenchyme present in the choroid. Please remember that. And you must be able to differentiate the embryonic origin of the ciliary muscle from the dilator pupillae and sphincter pupillae. The origin of dilator and sphincter pupillae is through the anterior or pigment epithelium, but origin of the ciliary muscle is through the mesenchyme of the choroid region. In this region, the mesenchyme, it proliferates to form, and it differentiates to form the ciliary muscle. Now, what is the attachment of ciliary muscle? Actually, anteriorly, this ciliary muscle is attached to this special shelf-like process at the iridocorneal angle. What is this iridocorneal angle? This is nothing more than the junction of cornea with the iris. So let me mark it here for you. This is the cornea. This is the cornea hole. This is cornea, and here is the iris. Now, at the junction of iris and cornea, this region is called iridocorneal angle. Iridocorneal angle. Now, at the iridocorneal angle, this sclera, our sclera, it forms a shelf-like process here. So here is the shelf-like process formed by the sclera. You see that tough fibrous sclera, it has formed this fibrous shelf-like process. And again, it is ring-like structure. You see, it is a three-dimensional structure. It is not just the single wedge here, and the name of this three-dimensional shelf-like structure is ciliary spur. Let me write it for you. It is called scleral, because it originates from the sclera. So it is called scleral spur. So anteriorly, the ciliary muscle, it attaches with the scleral spur, and it is almost fixed here. It is tightly attached here. It is fixed here. This is called scleral spur. It is attached and fixed with the scleral spur. This part cannot move. Only this distal part of this muscle, ciliary muscle, this part can move. So now, naturally, because this part of the ciliary muscle, because it is fixed, so what happens there? When the ciliary muscle will contract, it will move into this direction like this. Here also it will move into this direction. Now you see, as it will move, it will also take the overlying ciliary process along with it. And as it will take the overlying ciliary process along with it, what will happen, that the zonular, this attachment of ciliary muscle, zonular fiber, attachment of zonular fiber with the ciliary muscle, it will also move with that. And now what will happen, that let me show you the animation, that here is the contraction of the ciliary muscle. So what will happen, that these zonular fibers, which were initially quite taut, they were stiff, but now they have become less stiff. Initially it was like this, they were stiff, but as a result of this, as a result of contraction of ciliary muscle, they have become taut. So initially, as this ciliary muscle, as it was relaxed, then these fibers were taut, and because of this, these fibers were sort of pulling the lens capsule towards the, from the periphery, right? They were pulling the lens capsule from the periphery. So lens was less curvature, lens had the less curvature, lens was less globular. But as they become loose, as these fibers, they become loose, they become less stiff, what happens, that this curvature of the lens, it becomes more, the lens become more globular, the power of the lens, it becomes greater. So here is a use of this. Let me tell you why. For example, here is an object here. For example, this is a bottle here. Now, initially, let's suppose this bottle is much far away from our lens. So here is the lens, for example. Now, to focus this far object, it's very easy, that less curvature of this lens is required. Again, I'm not going into detail. It can easily focus at, let's suppose, this point. It can easily focus. But what happens, that if, for example, this same object, it comes closer, for example, this object is somewhat here. Now, because it is closer to eye, now to focus this, you need more curvature of the lens. Now it is not possible to properly focus it at the same point, it will be focused behind. So to focus it properly, the curvature of this lens must be greater. It should have more power. It should be a dynamic lens which can actually adjust the power to focus it like this. This is the basic principle of optics, and we will learn it in more detail when we will talk about the physiology of vision. But right now, please understand that this contraction of ciliary muscle, it is required for the accommodation of, for the near vision. When we want to see the near objects, this muscle must contract. And of course, it is contracting in a three-dimensional way like this. Please understand this. When I was a kid, I mean when I was a medical student, I thought that this is just a two-dimensional structure like this. So that's how we used to draw it, and that's how I thought that this is the structure of the ciliary muscle.